This video is a crash course on the navigation bar component, the navbar. And we'll start here by quickly covering the basics of a navbar, then we'll dive deeper into how we can fully style a navbar, the menu button in a navbar, we'll talk about reusing it on multiple pages, reusing the navbar, we'll talk about keeping a navbar at the top, a persistent navbar, we'll talk about adding a dropdown in a navbar, and if there's any time left, we'll talk about the measurable transfer of caloric energy that occurs when consuming a navbar. Let's start with the basics. How do we add a navbar? Over in the add panel, let's go in and grab a navbar to drag into the project. And we can place it anywhere, but for now, we'll place it directly inside our body element. And right away, we can see a few things. Let's go into our navigator over here. We can open and close this anytime. And inside our navbar, we have one thing and three more things. Those are the three to focus on. Our brand link, this is where we can put a logo. The nav menu, this is where we can have our navigation links. And menu button, which is currently invisible. Let's add a logo to our navbar. To do that, we'll just go to our assets panel. This is where we can upload and manage any of our assets. Let's drag our logo right into that brand link. And we can style this really precisely later. Right now, we'll just eyeball it. We can, of course, set top margin on the image we just dragged in, and the mouse isn't working.
It's right there.
Yeah, it's the battery.
Did you try replacing it?
You've been here.
I know.
The entire time.
Just keep teaching. I got this.
The second component in the navbar is the nav menu. This is what holds our navigation links, like home, about, contact.
Try this.
So if we want, we can go to our element settings. To our element settings.
You just said that.
This trackpad isn't working.
It's magic trackpad.
Is that really the most important thing right now?
Hang on, I got this.
If you were to select any of the navigation links, the nav links, and then you were to click to access the element settings panel, you'd see your link settings. This is where if you select any of the navigation links, then click on the element settings panel, you can see your link settings. This is where you can set each link to take you to a specific URL, another page in the project, a section on this page, you can set an email, set up a link to make a call, or attach a file. That's part one. Let's get into styling. So the biggest, most obvious thing, let's change our background color. To do this, with the navbar selected, choose a background color. What about the navigation links? Well, this is where classes start to help out a lot. We can create a new class with any nav link selected. We can name a new class. And if we make a change, like all caps, we can reuse this class on other links too. All we're doing is selecting the other links and applying the same class we just created. We're reapplying the nav link class. What does that mean? Not only did our all caps styling pass to each of these, but with any element selected that has the nav link class applied, we can change other stuff too. Notice how changes to letter spacing can affect all our nav links. We can also adjust our font size. And of course, our font color, maybe a dark gray color. Since the same class is applied to each of these, we can make any change we want later on. What about the nav container? The container that contains all of this. If you set the minimum width, min W, to 100%, you can have things span the entire width of the navbar. And of course, you can hold down Option or Alt and add some padding to both sides. For us, that container matches the rest of our design, so we'll undo. What about styling the navigation menu itself? If we go to tablet, this is where we can see the navbar. With the navbar selected, we can open and style the menu at any time over here in the element settings panel. We can press open menu and now we can change things. For instance, let's select nav menu from our navigator here and we'll set the background color to match the rest of our design. But that's styling the navbar. Let's talk about the menu button, which we cannot see. Why? Because by default, we're showing all our navigation links, all our nav links, in desktop view here. But if we go down to tablet, we can see the menu button, which is sometimes called a hamburger button. And if we go into preview mode, we can see that pressing the menu button shows the nav menu, our navigation menu from before. It displays each of those links. And it does this on tablet, mobile landscape, mobile portrait, but not on desktop. So how do we adjust that? Well, with the navbar selected, we can adjust from our element settings panel which views show a menu button. If we want to show the menu button on all views, we'll just adjust this to show on desktop. Menu button. For now, let's undo to set our visibility. Let's set the nav bar to show on tablet devices and below. That's the menu button. Now let's talk about reusing the navbar we just made. So let's open up a second page in our project. And as we start building out our second page, we'll want to drag in a navbar and restyle all the changes we've made over the last several minutes. Except we won't do that at all. We'll use a symbol. And it takes about 3 seconds to create one. First, we'll go back to our first page, the page where we created our navbar to create the symbol. We'll select our navbar, we'll right-click the label, we'll press Create Symbol. And Dylan will add a visual on the lower left side of the screen, which shows the keyboard shortcut for adding a symbol. Once we've created a symbol, we can use it anywhere we want, as many times as we want, like this other blank page. We'll go to Add, we'll select from our symbols area, the symbol we just created. We can drag it anywhere we want. That's reusing a navbar. Almost done here. Let's quickly talk about fixed navbars and sticky navbars. When something's fixed, when an HTML object is set to fixed positioning, it's placed around the viewport. That means even if we're scrolling through the page, the navbar is fixed to the same area inside the browser's viewport. But if we scroll back to the top, notice how toggling this, switching back and forth from static to fixed here, affects the positioning of everything else. Fixed elements don't push other stuff down. Everything is tucking behind the navbar when it's set to fixed. With the navbar selected, if we change our background color's alpha to something lower, we can see the section here tucks behind our navbar. So what's the difference between fixed and sticky? Let's set our navbar's position to sticky. And notice how, like it did for static positioning, the navbar pushes the rest of the page content down. Now, if we don't have a top value here, let's remove the one that was automatically added when we set the position to fixed, and we scroll, it behaves just like a static element. But here's the magic. Sticky positioning lets us set a top value. When the navbar is 0 pixels from the top of the viewport, we're telling it to stick. So, fixed positioning is the way to go if you want the rest of the page content to ignore the navbar. Things can tuck behind the navbar. And sticky positioning is the way to go if you still want the navbar to take up space at the top of the page while still sticking to the viewport. That's fixed and sticky. What about dropdowns? Let's cut to footage of the completed part of this section so we can see what we're going to build. Cut back.
Are you wearing different clothes?
Yes.
How even did you...
We can add a dropdown. This is also in the add panel. If we go down and grab a dropdown, we can drag it right into our navbar, right next to the other links already inside. And right away, with the dropdown selected, let's apply the same class we created for our other links. Once we do, let's go to preview mode and take a look. When we click our dropdown, we see our dropdown links. Click again, it goes away. What about on tablet or smaller devices that use a menu button? In this case, opening up the menu button, then opening up the dropdown pushes everything else out of the way, but you might want to style this. Let's go out of preview mode, and we'll go over and select our dropdown element, which now shows up in our navigator as nav link, since we applied that class a few moments ago. And at any time, over in element settings, we can press open menu. What does that do? Nobody knows, but it opens the menu. And we can see it's kind of a gray right now. What if we want it to match the same white color we're using on the navbar? Let's select our dropdown list. This is what holds all our dropdown links, and we'll set its background color to white, same as the navbar. But that's a dropdown element. Now, because we used styles, because we used classes on our elements, we can adjust multiple elements like the nav links here. Maybe we want to reduce that letter spacing a little bit. And we can continue to tweak our design with full control until it's pixel perfect. Sometimes this means adjusting containers or other aspects of our design so it can more properly align with other stuff on the page. So, we covered a lot in this video. It's impressive that Dylan was able to edit it down to 3 minutes.
What?
We covered navbar basics, navbar styling, hamburgers, how to make the navbar a symbol so we can use it on other pages. We changed wardrobe, we explained the difference between fixed and sticky positioning, and of course, we talked about a dropdown, which we can insert right into the navigation menu to create a dropdown. That's the navbar element in Webflow.